armies of workmen are still busy, replacing the thousands of buildings Italy lost in the war, or providing new houses for a growing population. There is less unemployment in the building trades than in any other. In Tuscany, in Umbria and Emilia up in the north, large-scale housing developments for workers are built or building. Much construction is better class housing for the well-to-do, however. All this activity in building has borne unexpected fruit. A new Italian architecture, fresh and bold in design, as in the superb railway station at Rome, a symbol in stone and steel of the cleansing freedom Italy is once more experiencing. For freedom in Italy is again a living thing. Once more, the Italian people possess the right to seek information and to know the truth. Their press is free to report the facts and to interpret them according to its independent convictions. Opinion, for two decades a monopoly of the fascist state, belongs again to the individual. The right to free and orderly assembly, taken away under fascism, has been restored under democratic government. To meet, to argue, to advocate. These, short of treason, are no longer crimes in Italy. For democracy need not fear the truth. Once again, the Italian people are free to exercise their forgotten rights as citizens, to participate in the sometimes unorderly processes of working democracy, to vote for and to elect a government of their own choosing. Along with Italy's rebirth as a free and democratic nation, there has been a rebirth of Italian intellectual life, a life that was stagnant during the years of fascism and war. Sprung up a whole post-war school of Italian writers and painters, their work known and acclaimed the world over. The Italian film industry, which was negligible before the war, is today one of the most lively and creative anywhere. Italy's post-war crop of actresses, headed by Anna Magnani, have won international renown. With first-class acting talent and technicians readily available, producers from other countries, men like Jean Renoir of Paris and Hollywood, are working more and more often in Rome. The startling outbreak of creative life in Italian film production since the war is no accident. Those who are themselves most concerned are convinced of this. Among them is Italy's young star, Gina Lollobrigida.
Credo che molti di voi siano d'accordo con me nel pensare che una cultura.
In any of the arts, real creative activity is only possible in a country where you're free to create the things you believe in. For instance, here in Italy under fascism, our movies were so bad the government almost had to pass laws to get Italians to go see them. Since we were liberated, they've won audiences all over the world because they're alive, like our country, and free. We've got something to say, and we're allowed to say it. And the other arts. Do you think Carlo Levi could have written his books, or Moravia his, under fascism? There are no great critics like Cechi without differences of opinion. And in my own field, the movies, it's only in a free country that a man like Vittorio De Sica could do the kind of honest, human pictures of social criticism he made out of Shoeshine and The Bicycle Thief. It takes a free people to be vital and creative, free to believe or disbelieve, to say yes or no, to be wise or foolish, according to its capacities. A nation of people like this won't be very orderly, but it will be alive and fruitful, and it will have the possibility of becoming something, the possibility even of greatness.
Away from the past. And if in today's turbulent world, the way ahead is likely to be neither very clear nor very smooth, Italy can count on one great source of strength, the mind and muscles and determination of free men, a free people, building step by step and with immense labor the best road they know how to a better future.